Thank you, and I first of all thank Professor Shahiza for giving me this opportunity to present this paper. Here in this paper, I would be broadly trying to map the incidence of disability and also the gender dimensions of it. So the context in which I locate the paper is that disability as a social construct. So for that, if you look at the literature in social sciences, you would see that the different types of marginalities have been dealt with across social sciences, whether it is gender or whether it is religion, region. But what has not got as much attention is the realm of disability. And in this context, even if you look at literature, you would see that there have been studies, but it has looked at more into the medical model of disability, focusing on prevalence, incidence, prevention, and all that. But we are not in this paper. I'm trying to analyze the gender dimensions of disability using the census of 2011. In the morning also, Mirash and I had pointed out to the fact that there is a dearth of data on disability. And in India, the latest data we have on a national level is that of the census 2011. And even when the 2001 has had captured the disability dimension, you can't actually compare the two because the definitions have changed. And you, for example, the person with one eye was not treated as visually impaired in the earlier one, whereas in this, so you actually cannot compare these two census. So my focus is all on the census of 2011, and in this I look at the prevalence first. What are the incidence of disability and various dimensions of it, the literacy status, the educational attainment in general, and also the workforce participation. So this is broadly the outline of my paper. So if you look at the census data, you have eight different types of disabilities which are listed, which is visually impaired, you have speech impaired, hearing impaired, locomotor disabled, persons living with intellectual disability, and you have persons living with psychosocial disability, any other, and multiple disabilities. In the census, the categorization is disability in speech, in hearing, mental illness, mental retardation, but I don't use those terms in my paper because even in the disability sector, it is not accepted words to be used as mental illness or mental retardation. So throughout the paper, I do not use those census terms, but I use these terms throughout my paper. And also, any other is a very problematic definition, I feel, because any other disability which is not listed or any other which the respondent could not identify does come under any other. So you would see that along with others, you have 18% who have reported that any other disability as one of the major category, which I think is very problematic. I think these are definitional issues which we need to tackle. Probably with the new bill, you have 19 new disabilities, 19 types of disabilities listed. So probably in the next census, this would be taken care of. And if you look at the disabled population by gender, around 56% is men and 44% is women. And the location, you see that most of them are located in rural areas, and this is also true across gender. And if you look at the disabled population by age, you find that 20 to 59, it accounts for 50% of the disabled population in India. And there is also an incidence of 30% at the age of 0 to 19. And in the census, we do not have a categorization of whether the disability was at birth or caused later. So this is the only thing which would give us any idea about the age group of the the prevalence of disability. And this is a very interesting thing about the prevalence of disability across union territories and states. You find that around 2.2% of the total population of India is disabled. And if you look at across states, there are few states which have more than 2.2%, and those are Odisha, Telangana, Sikkim, to mention a few. You can see that 3% in Telangana, 3% again in Sikkim. So the very, but if you look at where are the total populations of disabled people, it is highest in UP, 15.5%. Followed by Maharashtra, 11.11%. You have Chandigarh, 8.7%. So this is the total disabled population where they are situated. And but if you look at us as a proportion of total population, you see that there are several states which have higher percentage than the national average. And if you look at the literacy, I have looked at literacy levels and also the educational status. So if you look at literacy levels, of the total disabled population, 55% are literate. But if you look at male, it is 62%. But if you look at females, it is only 45%. So a huge number of the incidence of illiteracy is high among women. And if you look at, if I have also tried wherever I had data, I have looked at disabled population with non-disabled population, and you can see that the illiteracy among the disabled is more than the non-disabled. So the total disabled is 46, whereas in the non-disabled it is only 37%. And this is also true about rural India. The gap widens between the disabled and the non-disabled, the gap widens in terms of literacy status. But in case of urban India, we have a very very interesting picture. You have more number of, even though it is lower than the non-disabled, the percentage of literacy is 67% than you have in the rural area. So your location matters. And if you look at gender gap, so gender gap here, I have calculated the how many women you have for every 1,000 men, and I have taken a percentage of it. That is the gender gap we have calculated, and we have seen that there's a huge gender gap, especially in literate. Across, you can see that the red denotes the women. So you have a huge gender gap across educational levels, whether it is literate below primary or primary but below middle. Anywhere you see that there's a huge gender gap. And this is also true in case of rural India. And there's a wide gap. But in case of urban India also, there's a huge gap, but not as much as rural India. And if you look at the social groups, you see that others fare better than the SC and ST, and the lowest is among ST, and that is also true. And it is also true that across you have illiteracy among women more than men. And if you look by literates by disability, what is the kind of disability and how many literates are there in various categories, you see that the intellectual disability and the psychosocial disability and the multiple disabilities, you feel that they are the most, you see that they are the most excluded. And this was also true in case of certain micro studies we conducted at CSD. We had a national level study on higher education and persons with disabilities, and we found that across our sample, there were only two or three people who had returned themselves as persons with psychosocial disabilities or intellectual disabilities. And a proportion of who never attended institutions, you see that the disabled were more than the non-disabled. And it is also true across, you can see differences across disabilities. Again, here the multiple disabilities and those with psychosocial and intellectual disabilities are more excluded than. And if you look at the economic status, you can see that 64% of the total disabled were non-workers. So even if you look at the standard economic definitions of working status, you see that not in labor force usually includes the infirm and the disabled. But that doesn't mean that the disabled are not working. And category of workers, you again have within those who work, you see that 77% were main workers. Main workers means one who works for more than 180 days. So this is also true in case of across rural India. You see that you have more workers, less number of workers than in urban areas, and also non-workers is very high. Especially again in the intellectual and psychosocial disabled. And even if you look at sectoral composition here, we could see that agricultural laborers constitute the highest, and it is highest for women than among men. And if you, this is also true across SCs and STs. You see that even among SCs and STs, agricultural laborers constitute more among the disabled workers than the non, even if you compare it with non-disabled. So you could see that educational in terms of educational attainment and workforce, disabled are at an extremely vulnerable position. And in terms of economic status, more than 2/3 of the disabled populations were non-workers. And this is also, if you look at micro level studies, this picture you could also see in the micro level studies which are listed here. So it is important that we create an enabling environment. So you know that even at the entry level at school, there's an NCRT study which states that 1/8 of the total disabled who enroll only move beyond primary. So it's 1/8. So that's there where the barrier stands. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sonia. And actually, one of the most important things which I want to say, she didn't read because I made her not to speak. I apologize for that. So in the morning also, we said that I think we should all agree to make a recommendation to the government that the NSSO should conduct a special survey on the disability in India. And along with that, in the morning I told you something about the white dot spot issue, which is actually a major disease in India, which is afflicting girls. But there is another issue in India, which is in the disability statistics it doesn't come, but it is one of the most important disability facing the whole nation today. And that is the anemia. So, I mean, there is no country on the earth today, including poor African countries, where anemia among the pregnant and lactating mothers is so high. It is one of the biggest curse on India that somehow we as families and we as a nation do not adequately feed our mothers, sisters. I don't know about wives, that you will say. So now, continuing this discussion on disability, Shashank Awasthi, he will speak, and then please take 10 minutes, and then we'll move on to the next.
Thank you. I have only 65 slides to present. No, that's not. So, thank you for being here. Of course, Amir has tricked me into coming here. If I knew the kind of people who will be speaking, I would have never come. I tried to run away during tea time, but he caught me, and that's why I'm here. So I can do two things, I've realized. One is that, you know, I can tell you something really intellectually powerful, but there are far wiser people here in the room. So what I will do is I will try and offend you. I'll try and offend you in 5-7 minutes very quickly, hopefully very deeply also. And he's already shut off my presentation because of that. He's already offended. Yeah. So, you know, already one question. Sir, first slide laga denge. So we are at the panel discussion in case somebody didn't realize. Yeah. So why is this conversation even relevant? Why do we care about persons with disabilities? 36 jhanjat hai, bijli aati nahi hai, sadak kharab hai, train chal nahi rahi hai, pani peene ke liye hai nahi, disabled to dikhi nahi rahe. Why should we even care about them in the first place? So that I think is a very important question even before we start talking. So, you know, all the numbers have already been said, you know, 2.68 crores. I don't know if you know this, but jo census hai, matlab Hindustan mein 2.68 crore log aise hai jinhonne ye kaha ki main disabled hu ya mera bachcha disabled hai. ठीक है ये मतलब क्षमा चाहता हूँ माय लैंग्वेज इज़ वेरी पुअर यू नो सो प्लीज़ एक्सक्यूज माय सेइंग दिस बट दिस इज शॉर्ट ऑफ सेल्फ अब्यूज यू नो दिस जस्ट वन डिग्री हायर देन दैट बट 2.68 करोड़ पीपल रिकॉग्नाइज दैट राइट दे डोंट गेट एनी बेनिफिट्स देयर इज नो रीजन टू से दैट सो दिस इज सेल्फ डिक्लेयर्ड विच मीन्स थिंक ऑफ द नंबर्स दैट आर नॉट डिक्लेयर्ड राइट एंड ऑफ कोर्स द क्वेश्चन ऑफ हाउ मेनी पीपल नो दैट दे आर डिसेबल्ड और नॉट Right, so none of us here, of course, are disabled. I can see there's a gentleman there. There's another one walking with the crutches. But you know, I'm not. I'm a non-disabled person. You know, English bhi aati hai. You know, I can speak well and I'm educated and all of that. But I wear specs, which is an assistive device. But wo sab chalta hai. That's fine. Right. I saw one regulation wheelchair that's kept there, which of course brings me to one of my first points of being offensive. So one good thing is this is very classical of all disability and inclusion seminars. No disabled person can come here. First thing. ठीक है आ गया तो बेचारा कोई अगर deaf है तो उसको समझेगा ही नहीं व्हील चेयर यूजर है तो बेचारे को माने नहीं देंगे यहाँ पर सो आई थिंक इन दैट वीव डन अ गुड जॉब इन जनरल आई थिंक अ लॉट ऑफ क्वेश्चन दैट केम आई केम ओनली इन द आफ्टरनून आई एम सॉरी अबाउट दैट बट आई थिंक आई कम टू दैट इन जस्ट अ मिनट विल गेट आंसर्ड एज वी टॉक अबाउट डिसेबिलिटी बिकॉज इट विल ऑल्सो एक्सप्लेन लॉट ऑफ इशूज अराउंड जेंडर मैं सर से बात कर रहा था अबाउट यू नो वी एंड दे हम और वो I think as a society, our biggest strength and our weakness is that. We'll all find ways to become we, and we'll also find ways to become they. So now we can very merrily go out. We talked about patriarchy. Na? Patriarchy ko gender nahi hai. It doesn't need a man to be patriarchy. Na? Saas bhi karti hai, bahu bhi kar leti hai, nanat bhi kar leti hai, whoever can do it, right? So I think the same way in and around disability, we'll talk about that in just a moment. So just so you know, the number of people who raised their hand and said is more than the population of Australia. And also more than the population of Malaysia. Very, very large nations these are, right? If you look at 7 crores, which is some estimated study, you know, Meera only did that study and what have you, right? That would make it the 50th most populous country in the world. Agar duniya mein aap list banayenge, to 50th number se pehle hamare is Hindustan mein jo estimated number hai, wo hai.
Disabled.
Ji sir. By the way, this happens to be less than half of what the WHO says is the estimated disability because we are still learning about disability, which is supposed to be 1 in 6. So, but be that as it may, that's a reasonable, at any number, it's the largest number. But before you go home, you must take one fun fact home. We are the land with the largest number of persons with disabilities in the world. And persons with disabilities is the largest minority in the world. And for everybody else who thought that women are a minority, first fix that. Right, we are all the same species. वो जेंडर अलग है वो माइनॉरिटी नहीं है ठीक है माइनॉरिटी ये है दिस इज द लार्जेस्ट माइनॉरिटी इन द वर्ल्ड एंड ऑब्वियसली इट्स नो वेयर ऑन आवर रडार एट ऑल द सेकंड थिंग इज कॉलेज में वी शुड टॉक अबाउट एजुकेशन शी ऑलरेडी टुक माय थंडर अवे बाय सेइंग सो फ्यू पीपल मेक इट बट 40% ऑफ देम डोंट गो टू स्कूल्स 12% तो रजिस्टर ही नहीं कर पाए ठीक है उसके बाद 27-28% गए बेचारों ने रजिस्टर कर लिया उसके बाद ही कहीं पहुँचे नहीं क्योंकि स्कूल कहाँ है 640 और डिस्ट्रिक्ट है हिंदुस्तान में 450-450 आई डोंट इवन नो वेर आई गॉट दिस डेटा फ्रॉम इज द टोटल नंबर ऑफ डेफ स्कूल्स इन दिस कंट्री ऑफ आर्स अगर मैं डेफ हूँ और मैं कहीं 12वीं पास हो भी जाऊँ और मैं बहुत पैसे वाला बंबई और दिल्ली में रहने वाला आदमी हूँ तो भी टेक वन गेस व्हाट इज द टोटल नंबर ऑफ कॉलेजेस दैट आई कैन गो टू एज अ डेफ पर्सन वी डोंट हैव टाइम सर विल आस्क मी टू शट अप सो आई विल गिव यू द आंसर इट्स जीरो जीरो इज द नंबर ऑफ कॉलेजेस इन दिल्ली एंड बॉम्बे पुट टुगेदर फॉर पीपल हु आर डेफ And then we worry about inclusion, but we can talk about that a little bit later as we go along. You know, some discussion on literacy that we talked about. 45% illiterate hai. Literacy ka bhi koi threshold itna solid nahi hai ki aap koi form. And then we worry about inclusion, but we can talk about that a little bit later as we go along. You know, some discussion on literacy that we talked about. 45% illiterate hai. Literacy ka bhi koi threshold itna solid nahi hai ki aap koi form padh lenge aur apna naam likh lijiye utna hi literate hai. which is more than the highest rate of illiteracy in this country in any state. Agar aap sare states lijiye, usme sabse illiterate state kaun sa hai, forget about the name, usse zyada illiterate kaun hai? Person with disability, right? So I think that's where we are talking about. See, jo we aur they ka game hai, usme hum kafi T20 mein, you know, we are right up there. Right up there, winners by a long distance compared to everybody else. But sir, we'll go to the next slide. Obviously, I can't say much. Like I said, na, main intellectually to superior hoon nahi. So disability inclusion. Do hi slide hai mere. Ek disability ke baare mein, ek inclusion ke baare mein. Who's a person with disability? Kaun hai ye? Kyun nahi hai cripple, handicap, differently abled, specially abled? You know, matlab mera haath chala gaya. Just imagine, yahan se bahar nikla, airport jaate ho, accident ho gaya. Ek do haath chale gaye. Abhi now I'll become differently abled. हाथ गया कोई बात नहीं, एक और एबिलिटी आएगी कहीं से. आई डोंट नो कहाँ से आएगी, बट यू नो आई एम होपिंग कि मेरे साथ ऐसा नहीं होगा. सो हाउ डू वी यूज़ दिस लैंग्वेज, व्हाई डू वी यूज़ दिस लैंग्वेज, वेयर डज इट कम फ्रॉम, व्हाट डज इट मीन? दिस इज एक यूएन का कन्वेंशन है, गवर्नमेंट ने साइन किया है. हम तो सब टैक्स भरते हैं और जो गवर्नमेंट बोलती है वही करते हैं. सो वी यूज़ दैट लैंग्वेज. मोस्ट क्रिटिकल इन दैट, प्लीज नोट दिस लाइन विच इज अंडरलाइन एंड इन इटैलिक्स, विच सेज दैट पर्सन विद डिसेबिलिटीज हु हैव लॉन्ग टर्म सो एंड सो, विच इन इंटरैक्शन विद वेरियस बैरियर्स. This is disability. Disability is not having an arm or a leg or vision or intellectual disability. That is impairment. Impairment is not a problem. Nobody has ever told me ki aapki aankhein kamzor hain, is wajah se I will not let you into this room or you will not have access to A, B and C. वो सब मुझे इस चिपकाने के चक्कर में कि सर आपकी आंखों में दूर का नहीं दिखता तो ये लगाओ, पास का नहीं है दोनों जोड़ के लगाओ तो 10,000 का आपको मिल जाएगा चश्मा है. That's what they're trying to do to me. Nobody tells me that. The problem is the barrier. The disability is not my not having any senses that will stop me from coming here. The fact that there's a staircase, that is a barrier. So there are umpteen number of barriers here. We do the same in gender as well. हमको disability अगर समझना है तो हम जो लोग daily करते हैं आप उसको देखिए अलग अलग तरीके. सर ने anemia की बात करी. सर invariably always जो वुमेन बनाएगी वही बाद में खाना खाएगी. अभी हम लोगों ने तो किसी ने बनाया नहीं है. सो वी हैव नो एस्टिमेट कि खाना कितने लोगों के लिए, 6 लोगों के लिए खाना कितना बनाना चाहिए. और ख़त्म हो गया तो क्या? शी इज़ ऑब्वियसली नॉट गोइंग टू कुक, राइट? जो बचा कुचा है और एक्स्ट्रा रह गया तो क्या? नाश्ते में वही खाएगी. देन वी आर वरीड अबाउट हाउ कम 50% इज गॉट एनीमिया. ऑल्सो सिंस सर मेंशन्ड अबाउट एनीमिया, एनीमिया इज़ इंटरजेनरेशनल, विच मीन इट्स नॉट एज इफ कि हम एक जनरेशन को अच्छी तरह खिला पिला के फिट कर देंगे तो सब सही हो जाएगा. बट एनी वे दैट्स अनदर प्रॉब्लम. सो द फर्स्ट थिंग अबाउट डिसेबिलिटी रिमेंबर इज दैट इट इज आवर प्रॉब्लम हु आर टेक्निकली नॉन डिसेबल्ड. सो इट्स एन एक्ट ऑफ एक्टिव डिस्क्रिमिनेशन. सो प्लीज डोंट गो होम थिंकिंग हम कुछ नहीं कर रहे हैं. हम बिल्कुल अच्छी तरीके से डिस्क्रिमिनेट करते हैं एट एवरी पॉसिबल अपॉर्चुनिटी, बाय नॉट अलाउिंग समबडी टू बी एबल टू एक्सेस द मटीरियल, बाय नॉट अलाउिंग समबडी टू बी एबल टू कम एनी वेयर और टू बी एबल टू सी योर एक्सपीरियंस. So this is the first point that I want to make, and sir has already looked at his watch, so I'll go to the last slide very quickly. Ek upar wala sir. Ye hai sir, since disability and inclusion, as a disability ho gaya, abhi inclusion. So inclusion is the action, is a Wikipedia se hai, nothing much. Is the action or state of including or being included. It just seems pretty obvious. My key question is who's getting included? यू नो मैंने कुछ सालों पहले डिसेबिलिटी में काम किया, उससे पहले मुझे कुछ भी मालूम नहीं था. अनफॉर्चुनेटली मेरे पास कोई ग्लैमरस फिलोसॉफिकल स्टोरी नहीं है कि मैंने कुछ देखा, मेरे दिल में कुछ हो गया, मैंने सोचा मैं यही करूँगा. नथिंग लाइक दैट. हमारा स्टोरी एकदम ही बिल्कुल बेकार है. डिस्क्रिमिनेशन देखा, वी सेड वी हैव टू गो आफ्टर दिस कॉम्प्लिकेटेड प्रॉब्लम टू सॉल्व, लेट्स गो दैट्स. बट एनी वे, सो इंक्लूजन अगर आप देखेंगे, सो यू नो वी वर्क विद लॉट्स ऑफ पर्सन विद डिसेबिलिटीज, दे वर्क फॉर सम ऑफ द फैंसीस्ट बैंक्स, फाइनेंशियल इंस्टीट्यूशन, टेक कंपनी, सब अच्छी अच्छी कंपनियों में, जितने कांच वाली बिल्डिंग है ना, ऑल ऑफ देम हायर आर ट्रेनीज, or many of them at least. So who gets included? ये कहाँ से हमारे दिमाग में आ गया कि हम लोग किसी को include कर लें? हम तो किसी को include कर ही नहीं रहे हैं, हम तो discriminate कर रहे हैं daily. फिर अब हम suddenly कैसे include करने लगेंगे? So first off, let's get this right. We do not include persons with disabilities. We get included in their lives. If you were a business, I will give you data to show you that you would be a more profitable and a more successful business if you were having a wider range of people, right? And the same would apply for an education institution, and the same would apply for a society also, because then we'll have a better understanding of what barriers is, we'll have a better understanding of what inclusion is, hopefully it'll have a rub off on other things that we do. So two quick points. Disability is caused by barriers which we create. So that is one thing to remember. And the second thing is, it is not, we are not there here to be able to include somebody else. Persons with disabilities, whatever their lives are getting on very nice and fine without us, just like they are doing not being here at this session. So we have to find a way to get included in their lives rather than the other way around, because our lives are going to be richer. So this is a very selfish angle to take, maybe not a very fancy one, but that's how it is. With that, before sir asks me to go, I will take a leave. Thank you so much for your time.
Professor Abu Saleh Sharif, Professor Amir Ullah Khan, who is not here with us right now, my friend Dr. Zia, who thank you so much for inviting me and giving me this opportunity to come here and speak about some of my work. Since morning I've been listening about this discourse on equal opportunity, and what I decided to do in this short talk is to question some of the basic assumptions about Muslims and some of the basic assumptions about Muslims and Muslim, the so-called Muslim question in India. I've recently published the work based on my doctoral dissertation, which is on residential segregation of Muslims in Delhi. And I started with this basic assumption that a place of discomfort, basically, that every time the Muslim question or the issue of Muslims in India is discussed, it is usually talked of as a question of communal problem or the Hindu-Muslim relationship, or worse, it is spoken of as a problem of the faith Islam itself. So everything that happens to Muslim, everything that Muslims do is somehow sought to be explained in either the Hindu-Muslim enmity, so-called conflict and communal violence, or their faith Islam and its problems. What I thought, because I'm a social worker by training, and right now I teach in JNU in a center called Center for Study of Law and Governance, where I also teach courses related to urbanization and urban poverty. And it really interested me that there was very little attention being paid to coming up with a theoretical explanation as to why what is happening to Muslims is so. Especially the fact that it is the organized religion that is often pointed out as the source of all problems. But the other two main concentrations of our times, that the global world that we are living in, are often left off the hook. These are the modern nation state as we know it today and capitalism. These are the most important two concentrations of power. And so what is the impact of relationship that Muslims share with the modern Indian nation state, and the relationship that Muslims share with the largely political, largely capitalist society in which we are living in, capitalist, globalized society in which we are living in. So Hindu-Muslim question has all the impact, but what are the processes such as urbanization, gentrification, globalization, liberalization, what you have, privatization and so on, what kind of impact does it have on Muslims? And what kind of impact does the disciplinary state, the state that disciplines, its citizens? So state is often spoken of as something that is neutral, arbitrator of rights, as something, as an entity which is not biased, which doesn't take sides and so on. And when I say state, obviously, I don't mean only the government, I mean all arms of the state, including judiciary. So I started with this kind of question, and I don't have time to go into the details, but my main entry point in this question was to look at the issue of segregation, residential segregation of Muslims. You all know in most cities in India, Muslims live in separate neighborhoods, in different neighborhoods that are often pejoratively called ghettos or even mini Pakistans and so on. So what does it mean that they live in these so-called ghettos? And I looked at residential enclaves of Muslim population, a concentration of Muslim population, as actually segmentation of the labor market itself. So in one of the sessions in the morning, we were discussing how one would imagine that in the market economy, in a truly liberalized market economy, one would imagine that HR managers or whoever is in the position of taking decisions would actually not take decisions that are sort of motivated by some kind of prejudices or biases, but they would make rational decisions, which make economic sense. But as has been evidenced by this year's Nobel Prize, the whole idea of rationality in market economies has also been challenged quite strongly now. So my, coming from that angle, and I can't really describe in detail now, but what does it mean for the equal opportunity debate? Is that if we are looking at equal opportunity and the commission as it is being recommended by some of the reports that government has actually commissioned, basically want to sort of restrict the domain of equal opportunity to public education and public employment. But there's a little bit of confusion here, because while we want to and have to limit it to public education and public employment, we are also envisaging the society as a largely capitalist society in which we hope that in the market economy, everybody will get their rational fair share, whereas that doesn't happen. There has been some work on it, and actually quite strong empirical reports, studies done. Professor Thorard, for example, did a study in which he sent out exactly identical CVs with upper caste Hindu name, with a Dalit name, and with a Muslim name, and he found out clear statistical evidence of bias in terms of how many calls these fictitious candidates got for interviews and so on. So in these studies, it was found that while the Dalit or the SC candidates were disadvantaged, the most disadvantaged were actually the Muslims. And we are not talking about public sector employment and reservations and those sort of things. We are talking about market economies. So my theory or proposal is to say that in the capitalist society, in the capitalist liberalized market economies, identities also have material content. And people, harbor prejudices, behave in discriminatory manner, not because they hate each other and religions are bad or religious or faith inspires bad communication and so on, or Muslims and Hindus hate each other, but that it makes material sense that capital can be accumulated through processes of discrimination. One example that I will give is that of, like I said, segmentation of labor markets, that certain kind of labor is incarcerated. I will use the word incarcerated into certain areas, and therefore they are not in a position to bargain for a better price in the market. Similarly, and this is not something that is peculiar only to Muslims. This is how capitalism works. This is how accumulation of capital functions through segregation. I don't have time to give a lot of examples here, but I want to make another point before I finish, is to talk about some of my other work, which is on the idea of how we understand law. For example, there's a doctrinal law, the black letter of the law as it can be read in legal documents such as constitution and so on, but also that there is a law as it exists, and Flavia Agnes and Audrey have already spoken so eloquently about it, so I won't go into it, but I will. So in one way, I've talked about capitalism and modern nation state, but also to look at law as something, or especially Constitution of India, as something that is totally neutral. And we often talk about how we have this wonderful constitution and we have these really nice laws that, and the problem is only of implementation. I would like to forward a thought here, which challenges this notion that it is actually in the letter of our constitution itself that some of these problems are rooted. Professor Sharif in the morning asked about whether our constitution mentions equal opportunity. It does actually in the preamble itself, and it promises us liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith and worship. It also promises us equality of status and of opportunity. And Article 14 of the Constitution actually proclaims the principle of equality and equal protection of law for all. So it is important for minorities, if, you know, equal protection of law is provided to everybody, it is an interest of the minorities. But this equality is actually qualified in the Constitution itself by a provision contained in Article 15 and 16, which we have discussed all this this morning, extensively amended since the Constitution was promulgated. These qualifications actually pertain to special provisions for children, women, backward classes, scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. And the word minority itself has actually been used in the Constitution only twice, in Article 29 and Article 13, where also it has not been defined. It is mentioned only in relationship to religious and linguistic minorities. But who are these minorities? So, these minorities have actually been given in the Constitution a right to maintain their cultural specificity. That's all they've got. And they've been promised that there will be prevention of discrimination on basis of any kind of identity. How has it been deployed? Now, this has to be read with Article 25 and 28, which actually provide for freedom of conscience and freedom of religious liberty. But I'll read out a little bit of explanation. It's called Explanation 2 in the Article 25. It reads thus, and I quote, "In subclause B of clause 2, the reference to Hindus shall be constructed as including a reference to person professing the Sikh, Jain or Buddhist religion, and the reference to Hindu religious institutions shall be construed accordingly." So if you look at specifically, so I'll give only two very small examples. If you look at specifically of the case of Jain in India, who were very recently in 2014 given the status of minorities, and some scholars, this is not my work, I'm quoting other scholars such as Manisha Sethi, who have worked on the issue of Jainas, who have been actually lobbying with the government, even colonial government, since 1909 for a minority status. And while they oppose the claim of political rights as minorities from within the community, but they also wanted some kind of protection that their cultural identity as Jainas is not subsumed under the Hindu identity. So what did this lead to? They wanted all the privileges of being Hindus by law, but they also wanted this protection. It led to what Manisha Sethi calls cleavage of the definition of Hindu. So that what we have in the Constitution of India is something that is called Hindu by faith. There are people who, when they report their faith, their religion, they say they are Hindus. But there are also people who report themselves of belonging to other religion who are also understood as being Hindus by law. So the Hindu identity actually is, cleavage. And the four statutes which actually together form the Hindu personal law, which may come as a surprise to most people in popular discourse that Hindus also have a personal law. It's not only Muslims who have a personal law, which is always sought to be demolished. But in the Hindu personal law, which recognizes Jains, Buddhists and Sikhs as Hindus in law, even though they are, not Hindus by faith, and they are, in fact, they have the minority status. What does it mean? I mean, what does it mean that they are Hindus in law? It means various other things, but one of the things it means is that they are able to run their educational institutions, which are called minority institutions, and it is considered one of the most prized things for a prized right or a privilege for a community to run these institutions and of course also be administered through their own personal laws. So one of the things that has for a very, very long time escaped the scrutiny, public scrutiny and scrutiny by scholars until very recently, is the provision of Hindu undivided family. And recently there's been a lot of debate on the Hindu undivided family. Now this cleavage of religious identities of Jainas and Buddhists and Sikhs, who are Hindus by law, but by faith they are not Hindus, and they were deemed Hindus for accruing wealth accumulation under the tax exemptions that have been extended to the Hindu undivided family. So if you look at the Constitution of India, the whole idea of who are Hindus by law and who are Hindus by faith also actually excludes specifically religions such as, or people professing religions such as Islam, Christianity, mostly being sizable minorities, but also Jews and Parsis, who of course are in no need of the reservation or positive discrimination policy. Now this loophole for tax avoidance is not a small thing. It is actually a huge corporate tool which is inconsistent with the modern corporate governance and taxation structure of India, and it allows corporate entities within India, which are actually all family owned corporate entities. So when we talk about Ambanis, Adanis, Tata, Birla and so on, we are talking actually about family owned corporate entities which are using this big loophole created for capital accumulation to be used only by Hindus. And this provision in taxation law, which has evaded scholarly scrutiny for a very, very long time, the issue of exclusion of Muslim lower caste or what could have been scheduled caste Muslims has already been discussed, so I won't go into it. And I will conclude by only saying that even if you look at the Constituent Assembly debates, the trade-off that has been taken off between preferential treatment for the lower caste and cultural rights for minorities. So what they got, preferential treatment in many other things, whereas minorities got cultural rights. That has proved to be disadvantageous for the minorities, and it has meant that the real problems of the minorities in terms of livelihood and access to resources were actually not tackled. So what do we do? And since I think of myself as a political theorist, I'm not really a policy person. The couple of things that I want to say in terms of what we do is,
you need to conclude.
Just one point. Okay. Thank you.